Welcome in. It's episode 29 of Covering the Bases, the official podcast of USA Baseball. I'm Daron Vaught. As always, thanks for pressing play, downloading, subscribing, and a thank you in advance, as I humbly request, that you rate and review the show wherever you get your podcasts. Remember, we're available on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, and every episode is also uploaded to the USA Baseball YouTube channel. One of the most inspiring, most fascinating baseball journeys in the history of the sport is that of Jim Abbott. Jim was born on September 19th, so he actually has a birthday coming up in just a few days. Happy birthday, Jim, of the year 1967, and he was born without a right hand. Despite that, he grew up to become an All-American pitcher at Michigan, a star immediately afterward for Team USA in the 1988 Olympics, and a major league hurler immediately following that, with no minor league service in between. His 10-year career included a memorable no-hitter at Yankee Stadium as a member of the home team. That was September 3rd, 27 years ago, earlier this month. What better time for perhaps our most heartening interview to date? But first, a couple of questions for our Senior Director of Development at USA Baseball, Will Crisco, who is going to tell us a little bit about the inaugural USA Baseball Day of Giving. Will, I hope you're doing well. Why don't we get started with, very simply, what is the USA Baseball Day of Giving?
Yeah, thanks, Daron. Appreciate you having me on. Certainly an exciting time for us at USA Baseball. This fundraising campaign officially kicks off September 30th of this year. We're really excited for a day-long, 24-hour fundraising event where alumni, friends of USA Baseball, general USA Baseball fans can come together in the USA spirit and make a contribution and participate and pay it forward to enhance the future of all Team USA athletes for generations to come.
So, Will, what areas can Day of Giving donors support? What, I mean, in other words, what would these donations be going towards specifically?
Sure. So obviously, the USA Baseball, the organization, has evolved an incredible amount over the years. And we have program and area specific funds for alumni, for fans, for donors to identify, you know, which program of USA Baseball has impacted and touched their lives the most. You know, whether that's the 12U national team, our 15U national team, our collegiate national team, our women's national team, or, you know, just general USA Baseball funds that address the greatest needs of the organization. We have identified a number of different areas for folks to direct their support to further the future of the organization.
And what about a minimum donation or gift amount? Is there one? I'm imagining a variety of people with different levels of expendable income that would be inspired to donate to this cause.
Absolutely. So we do have a minimum gift amount through our online giving platform, which is $10. But, you know, our goal through this day-long 24-hour fundraising campaign is participation. And, you know, we would love to have strength in numbers. You know, the size and the amount of your contribution, you know, really does not matter whether it's $10, $100, $1,000. All contributions support the future of USA Baseball. They're all significant. And, you know, by you combining your philanthropic support with, you know, some of your other teammates, some of your other friends, family members, the impact on, you know, collective coming together for a cause like USA Baseball is really significant and have a lot of impacts on the future of the organization.
And other than a financial gift, what else can people do to support the Day of Giving?
there's a number of ways where we encourage folks to get involved. Social media is probably the biggest aspect of that for us. We have an incredible following and great presence on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, LinkedIn as well. And, you know, the biggest thing that we hope for people to do is, you know, share your message, share why USA Baseball means so much to you. How has the organization impacted your life, both personally and professionally? And, you know, why would you want someone else to support the organization? And, you know, what really inspired you to make an impact and make a gift to the organization that supports our future?
And finally, for Will Crisco, Senior Director of Development at USA Baseball, if someone listening wants more information on the inaugural USA Baseball Day of Giving, where would you direct them?
More information can be found at our giving website, which is giveforglory.com, or folks can go to usabaseball.com. We've got a ton of resources available on both places. And folks can also reach out to me directly. My email address is available on our website, but you can reach out to donate@usabaseball.com.
Nice. So that's it. Will Crisco, appreciate the time, man. We're all looking forward to getting this thing kicked off, the inaugural USA Baseball Day of Giving.
Absolutely. Thanks, Daron. Appreciate you having me on.
Now, without further ado, Jim Abbott on episode 29. Of Covering the Bases. Colin, roll the open, please.
From high above Coleman Field at the USA Baseball National Training Complex in Cary, North Carolina, this is Covering the Bases with Daron Vaught.
What do you remember about first playing sports as a youngster?
Well, I loved sports from the very beginning. I grew up in Flint, Michigan, and Michigan is a great sports state. I mean, obviously we have the seasons up there, so you get a chance to dabble in a little bit of each of the major sports, you know, basketball, football, baseball, and those were all the things that I gravitated towards. And I really loved it. All my friends were athletes. We played touch football when we could. We played tackle football when we could. We played baseball when we could. And really that's how we filled up our days, no matter what season it was. So I was drawn to sports from a very early age, and it's how I made a lot of my friends. It's where I found a lot of my footing in life.
Aside from that, what was it like in everyday life? As you know, growing up, we all have our series of issues or problems or things that we are dealing with during those formative years. What was it like growing up and especially as a kid who liked sports and being different physically in those terms?
It was, and I try to be careful because I don't want to create a narrative now, because I did truly at the time just love sports. I that's how I fit in, and it's a story that's told a lot, but for kids who feel a little bit on the outside looking in, sports provides refuge in a lot of ways. One simply is being picked on a playground. You know, that means a lot in second grade at recess. And maybe you've had a tough day in the classroom, a few awkward glances in the hallway, fighting those fears and those insecurities, to walk out on the playground and have one of your buddies pick you for the team, you know, that goes a long way. So, I don't think it's too big of a leap to say, although I love sports, I do know that feeling meant a lot to me growing up, and it probably provided even a stronger pull to participate
Now, you've got another no-hitter of note that we're going to talk about eventually, but I've read, is it true that you tossed a no-hitter in the first baseball game you ever pitched?
I think so. I'm pretty sure it was a no-hitter. I walked a lot of guys, so it seemed to be a common theme as well. But
technicalities, it's fine.
I always had a pretty good arm. I could throw, I can't explain why one arm is different than another one. Why some people can throw the ball with velocity and other people can't. It's just a strange deal. But I was blessed in that way in my left arm. And from the second I stepped on the mound, it was just something that I could do, and I enjoyed it. And that was a fun way to get started on my pitching career, although I was probably in tennis shoes and wearing blue jeans that day.
I think one of the reasons, obviously, is being born without your right hand and having success despite that. And it was just such a cool story throughout your career, because you had developed this way, this technique, to when you were pitching, you throw with your left hand, obviously, and then transfer your glove to your left hand. And you were a pretty good fielder while doing that. How did you come up with and develop that technique for, if I want to play baseball and I'm going to have to do it a little bit differently than everybody else, so we're going to enterprise our way through a technique here?
Well, Daron, yeah, enterprise is a great word for it. It was something I started, doing with my dad in the front yard when I wanted to just play catch, let alone, get on a field and play. And it was an evolution. It took some adjustment. I was very cumbersome and slow with it, even in high school. Although I was having success and my story was becoming more known. I had a glove that was way too big for me. My hand got lost in it. I lost the ball in it. It just it was cumbersome. So I get questions all the time to this day from kids who are growing up in the same situation, looking for a tried and true way to switch the glove on and off. And enterprise is a great word, because there is none. It was just what came easiest to me. And for the life of me, I can't describe it in words. It doesn't, I've tried a million times. I just transferred the glove. I kind of spun it and held it and grabbed the ball and then threw, so it really wasn't until college, I went to University of Michigan and we had access to, really great equipment. I got a new glove. It was smaller. And my coach recognized the fact that at that level of competition, fielding would become more and more important. And he was right. And we really started to work on my fielding. I take a lot of pride in my fielding. I worked really hard at it. And I never felt like it was a deficiency, really, truly, after my college days.
Is that the sort of thing that... And look, you overcame a lot as a youngster, even getting drafted out of high school before deciding ultimately to go to Michigan, like you said there. Was there a bit of a fire, sort of a chip on your shoulder because of what you were defying, that made you want to be one of the better fielders out there? And I mean, I don't know if the same applies for, it could apply for any sport that you played. I know you played high school football and were a pretty good hitter in baseball as well. Is that something that fueled you at all?
I think it did. In a way that was quieter. I think sometimes there's, you give the impression that I had this burning chip on my shoulder, which it doesn't seem quite right. I wanted to prove myself. I definitely did. And there was a drive and an ambition there that, truly wasn't always pretty. But there was a loneliness to it too. There was a little bit of sadness. There was always feeling a little bit on the outside looking in. And so I, I, instead of lashing out, I sort of drew inward, and that translated into harder work. You know, I would go, even in basketball, go shoot more baskets, or, you know, go throw the ball baseball against the wall, or go work on something. And so I think it helped me to have a good work ethic. And, but the inside drive of that was always, you know, a little bit of loneliness and a little bit of feeling different and of not quite fitting in.
You know, I don't know if you've necessarily thought of it in these terms, but you do mentor young people with similar circumstances today, and I would imagine have thought about different perspectives that you've gained through your life to this point. But I'd be interested to know, do you believe that you would have had as much success had you been born with both hands? Just given the extra drive that it gave you?
That's a question that I've thought a lot about. I mean, truthfully, you know, how would it have been? Not in a longing way. I mean, I certainly don't, I don't think I've ever truly wished, God, I wish I had two hands. I've never thought of it that way. As I've gotten older, I've come to really, as I got over the insecurity of it, you know, the playground, school hallways, you know, and even today walking down a, you know, wherever I may be, an awkward glance here and there, you know, a young person's awkwardness, in saying hello to me. I've never looked back on it like that. Like, wow, what if I'd had two hands? Could I have been a better pitcher? I do believe that we are the sum of our experiences, and you know, having one hand made me who I am. Like I said, it provided a drive and a push and an ambition. And it wasn't always pretty. It, you know, there was a lot of emotion to it. But I wouldn't change a thing. You know, it's taken me to places I never would have gone without it. It's allowed me a unique perspective, and frankly, I'm very proud of how people have connected to my career. You know, I was a sub 500 pitcher in the major leagues, and that I guess one loss record doesn't matter as much as it used to, but you know, there's still a wonderful connection that I have with baseball fans around the country, and people who relate to my story, and they remember games that I pitched and places that I pitched. So all of that adds up to being a pretty wonderful journey, you know. And I know that having one hand, you know, played a big part in all that, if not the entirety of it. So would I have been able to do anything differently? I don't know. Maybe I'd be a better golfer. Maybe I'd be this or that. But I wouldn't change a thing. I mean, it is who I am, and I'm very thankful for it.
I love that response. That's a wonderful perspective. And again, people admire you for your perspective and the things you've said along those lines over these years. Well, you've been raising children on your own, so you know the nuances of parenting and how protective parents can be. I personally am not a parent, so I can only imagine those scenarios. When it came to your parents, who were very young and by all accounts worked hard, stretched themselves pretty thin at times, how did they handle advising you about your place in the world growing up differently than your peers?
My parents were my heroes, and I've said that many, many, many times. And not because they were perfect. They would admit that, you know, it was as you mentioned, there were some real rough patches in my childhood and my brother's childhood, and our family struggled to, you know, make it. My parents were very young. They faced challenges right from the get-go in their relationship and in their marriage and in raising a child. Let alone one with physical differences, missing a hand. I still try to put myself in their position, and I can't. I can't imagine the fear that they must have felt. But I am amazed they were really balanced about it. And that's what I'll always be thankful for. You know, my parents didn't baby me. They didn't shield me from experience. You know, they didn't encourage things that would maybe only make sense for people with two hands. And, most of all, they encouraged me to get out there on a playground, you know, to participate, to be a part of something, even though they knew it would probably bring about, you know, some discomfort. And, so it influences the way I think about my own kids, as hard as it is to watch them push themselves and into places of discomfort and to struggle. It just is something that has to happen. And in talking to kids like me, in talking to their parents, I get so much inspiration from the love and support that parents and families have for kids now. I think there's so much more tolerance and acceptance than there ever was, especially even when I was growing up. And the only time I worry is when, you know, a parent or a family member tries to gloss over the experience and tries to, you know, you're perfect, and you know, that's just not the case. It's gonna hurt. You know, there's times when it is painful. It's awkward. And you just got to keep going. And so, that influences my advice. I'm, you know, no expert, but that was my experience.
You mentioned your own children. I would like for you to tell the career day story. I think this is from your book that you wrote with Tim Brown, Imperfect. And I've heard you explain it as sort of the reason you decided to put this in writing and in book form. But it was career day at school with your daughter, and what happened?
Well, if it's one of my favorite stories, it just sort of struck me later after it happened that, you know, wow, that sums up a lot of things in my life. And, I was invited to, well, all dads were invited, to come to career day at a pre-kindergarten class my youngest daughter was involved in. And, you know, it's kind of funny because I was retired from baseball at the time, although I was still in my early 30s. It was awkward to try to explain that I have no career to speak of. So I went in and you know, I talked about baseball and kids are kids, right? You know, I'm sitting there and looking down at this group and I never addressed the fact that, you know, my right hand, I didn't talk about it. I just talked about, you know, baseball things, you know, and the lessons that we learned from competition. And I got these funny questions, as you know, all everybody does when you go into those environments. You know, do you have a dog? You think you're making these, you know, life changing, you know, statements to these kids, and you find out that absolutely nothing is absorbing.
Yeah.
But after a few awkward questions, I was just kind of finishing up, and my youngest daughter raised her hand, and she asked me right there in front of her teachers, in front of all her friends, if I liked my little hand. And, you know, it really stopped me in my tracks. You know, did I like my little hand? And, I didn't know what to make of it, you know, because obviously I don't know how long she'd been thinking of that. Maybe for a lot longer than just in our time right there in the classroom. And, you know, it really summed up a lot. And I remember thinking and saying to her, you know, I do, you know, it goes to what we were just talking about a minute ago. I do like my little hand, and I don't know where you called it my little hand. We never called it that at home. But you know, it just like I said earlier, it is who I am, and it took me to places I never would have gone without it. And it gave me the idea that if you can be a little bit creative, you know, if you can find a different way of doing things, and make the most of what you have been given, put the emphasis on what you have been given rather than what's been taken away. And most importantly, in times of discomfort and loneliness, if you can believe in yourself and that you can make it through, you know, that most anything is possible. And so I've really loved that story myself, and I thought a lot about it, and you know, it really helped me to come to grips with having one hand and understanding the impact that has had on my life.
Back to baseball, at what age, because again, you're with your circumstances, not that it would be discouraged as a whole, but I think everyone can understand that some doubt would creep its way into your mind when you're a young baseball player and you think, well, you know, I'm good. I might be good enough to make it to another level, but I'm not the same as everyone else, right? At what age did you start to think baseball collegiately or professionally could be in the cards for you?
That's, you know, that is a heck of a question. I never really thought of it like that. You know, I took great satisfaction in doing well and the attention that it brought to me. You know, when I was pitching in Little League, the local paper would make a big deal of my games and you know, but it was an uneven journey. You know, I really just wanted to make the next team. I mean, that was kind of what I thought. Growing up in Flint, Michigan, was a great place, and I was encouraged at every turn. And that's something I say to everybody, you know, coaches and parents and teachers literally pulled me into the game. And I mean that at almost every level. It wasn't me battling against the mean coach. That wasn't it. It was being invited. It was being called. It was, you know, kids on the team signing me up, you know, that it was that kind of thing. So, you know, I just wanted to make the next team. And in middle school, played on the ninth grade team. I was the only kid who didn't get a hit on the team, you know, and I was embarrassed and humiliated. And the next year I, you know, tried out for the varsity team and I didn't think I'd make it, and I made it and I did well. So, it was always about the next level, and I wanted to play on the Connie Mack team that was very good locally. And I, you know, had that chance. And then, you know, going to Michigan really kind of opened the door for me in terms of what I thought I might be able to do. And because I'm playing in the Big Ten, you know, we were playing against very good teams. And then that gave me the chance to play. Really wasn't the USA baseball platform. Truly was the first time that I started thinking about professional baseball, and because I was playing, you know, with the best college players in the country and holding my own. So, it, up until that point, even though I was drafted by the Blue Jays, it just didn't seem real. You know, I didn't feel like I was quite at that level yet. So, that's why I cherish my time with USA Baseball, because it really was the springboard to my belief that, you know, I could play with anybody.
Over at usabaseballshop.com, have you seen the new mask from Baseballism? Now available in gray, all proceeds from the sale of the USA Baseball gray face mask from Baseballism will be donated to Pitch In for Baseball and Softball, a nonprofit organization that collects and redistributes baseball and softball equipment to children in need. So help a charitable cause while helping others by wearing your USA Baseball mask from Baseballism and usabaseballshop.com. Well, let's get into those two summers then. I mean, this is the USA Baseball podcast after all. The summers of 87 and 88, you were a member of the collegiate national team. At that point, that was of even greater prominence because in 1988, it included representing the United States in, you know, usually it's the Pan American Games or the World Cup of Baseball. But that summer, you got to pitch in the Olympic Games. Beginning with 1987, the very first time you had been selected for the team, how did you find out?
It was a process. You know, I was, after my sophomore year at Michigan, I had a really good season, and I was invited to play at the Cape, you know, where, you know, the Cape Cod, where they have the great college baseball league. And I was really excited about that. And then I got an invitation to come down to Millington, Tennessee, where USA Baseball was headquartered at the time, and try out for the USA team. And there was no guarantees that you would make the team. It was just simply, you're invited. Hmm. And I thought, well, I'll go down and try. And then you know, see what happens if I end up, you know, I can go back to the Cape for the summertime. But I went down there and we met in these naval barracks on a Navy base in Millington, Tennessee. My first guy I sat down with and my first roommate was Greg Olson, the relief pitcher from Auburn, you know, and looking around the room, you know, where there were all these great collegiate players. And it was really something. Ron Frazier, you know, the legendary baseball coach from Miami, was our head coach that year. And he kind of walked by me in the hallway and kind of shook his head and laughed and said, you know, Abbott, do they even play baseball up north where you live? And so I ended up making the team in Millington. And so I canceled my plans to go to the Cape, and we ended up traveling, you know, all around the United States, went to Cuba that summer and the Pan Am Games. So, you know, it wasn't like you're invited, you're on, you made it. You're welcome to try. And so I'll never forget those naval barracks. I'll never forget how hot it was in Tennessee, but just how cool it was, you know, to be out there with those guys, you know, who I read about in Baseball America and all the newspapers.
You mentioned Greg Olson. If I'm not mistaken, Frank Thomas was on that first collegiate team that you were on, another Auburn guy, or maybe he would have been the following year. Needless to say, it is a huge collection of baseball talent. What were your impressions pitching against them, playing against them throughout those trials and seeing a lot of these guys? I mean, you had seen good baseball playing at Michigan up to that point, but to have it all sort of congregate right there in one place, what was that like?
It was really fun. You know, I remember as much about the shenanigans back at the barracks. You know, once the team started whittling down and we started to become familiar with each other, Mike Fiore from, you know, Miami, Eddie Sprague from Stanford, you know, some of these guys would become just real, Tino Martinez, just really, really great friends. And you know, the spirit of it all was so cool. I really think of it as being the best team experience that I ever had playing baseball, you know, because all the cliches held true. You know, nobody was paid to be there. I don't even think the coaches were paid to be there. Obviously, we were all amateurs. None of us that year, only a couple of us had been drafted. And so it was everybody was in it to play for that team and for each other. And, you know, you're talking about guys who were all conference or, you know, out in the Pac-12 or all conference in the Big West or, you know, all American, you know, down in Florida. And yet none of that mattered. It was your role was what was asked of you on that day. And there was no grumbling. There was no, oh God, I'm better than that guy, or I don't want to pitch out of the bullpen. I don't want to be a pinch runner. It was what can I bring to this team? You know, how can we go out and compete against Cuba tonight? And truly, you know, Major League Baseball is phenomenal. But I would think anybody who plays Major League Baseball will tell you that it's not quite the same when you get to the professional ranks.
So you mentioned you guys went to Cuba that season, and you were part of this great Team USA moment because the United States hadn't sent its first baseball team to Cuba until 1979. And your win in an 8-3 victory that you pitched in was the first triumph by the U.S. in Cuba since 1960. Formal relations between the nations had ended at that point. I've seen video footage of this game, and the raucous crowd. And look, I mean, I've gotten a pretty good taste because I do games for the collegiate national team now, and I've gotten a pretty good taste of culturally how other countries treat the game of baseball. Had you been exposed to any kind of international baseball to that point? I'm curious to know what your thoughts were going into Cuba and pitching against Cuba in front of all of their fans. And to boot, I mean, Jim, that team had Victor Mesa on it, whom you faced. And it was by the Cubans' measures, they're legends too, right? Just like we were trotting out a Jim Abbott, a Frank Thomas, a Greg Olson, a Tino Martinez. What was that experience like?
It's really funny. I think I think you could almost write a book about that. There were so many things involved, and I'll try to not go on and on and on about it, but. It was just really cool. It's hard to describe. It's hard to overstate how passionate other countries are about baseball, and in particular how passionate Cuba is about their baseball players and their baseball team. And you've probably followed it. It's a real process of selection for them, and used as a way to sort of. As propaganda, you know, for them to show their way of life. It used to be, it may not be quite the same as it is now, but, it was this, you know, this source of national pride, and kids on the team, they had a third baseman named Omar Linares, who, anybody would tell you was the best player on the field. Whenever we played them, he was just extraordinarily talented and a lot of fun. And so this was the best they had, you know, and they took tremendous pride in it. And, we were just a bunch of college kids, a couple of us had been to I had never been to the College World Series, but a few others on our team had. So I guess they played in front of a few people, but we just weren't used to playing in front of 50,000 people in a huge downtown stadium in Havana, you know, with Fidel Castro in the stands. So it was really, really cool. The Cuban people were extraordinarily nice to us. The Cuban players were fun. We had a real tough rivalry. And, you know, in addition, you know, my playing with one hand was a source of fascination to them. You know, it really was, to a point where I was uncomfortable. You know, there were pictures of just my hand in the newspaper down there, and they filmed every step of, you know, every time I stepped on the field, there were cameras, there were, you know, this finger pointing and this sort of gasping almost that, you know, and I think it goes towards, you know, their program, their baseball program, where, you know, only the best of the best, you know, the most physical specimens, you know, move through their system. And so, you know, when I pitched against their team, and we won, there was this sense of like disbelief, and it was almost as if we kind of turned the Cuban fans to our side a little bit. They were cheering for us a little bit. And we went from sort of being, you know, America to sort of being the underdogs. And it was a fascinating experience. And I will never forget, you know, after that game, we did some media interviews and the team was sitting on this bus. We were waiting to go back to the hotel, and it was just Ron Frazier and I. And we were just mobbed by the Cuban fans, and we could barely get back to the bus. And we got on the bus and we were driving back through the streets and people were following us and pounding on the bus and cheering. And it was one of the great highlights of my career. I think anybody who was there will tell you it was extraordinary.
And you were what, 19 years old at the time? Maybe 20?
Yeah, 20, I think. You know, okay. 19, 20, somewhere in the, just about to turn 20.
Sure. Right. Had you traveled internationally up to that point? I mean, you know, you guy from Michigan, humble beginnings. It's a little bit different than it is now. Just travel is a little bit more accessible for these guys, not to mention, you know, good players are in showcase environments at an even earlier age. So most of the time they're traveling more and getting to know each other more before they get put in those, the collegiate national team like situations. Had you done any traveling or any of the other guys?
No, I mean, no, it wasn't this was our only real trip of the year. We traveled all summer. But it wasn't glamorous. I tell you, we were on school buses. And, it was like a low minor league experience, and that's not to denigrate it. I wouldn't change a thing. It was what it was. We loved every second of it, but it wasn't glamorous. We didn't stay in fancy hotels, and we carried all of our own equipment. And Cuba was, there was such a lead up to it. You know, it was, we trained down in Miami, at Ron Fraser's facility down there to get ready for it. And he was such an ambassador for the game. He was very fun with the press. And so with the Cuban community down there in Miami, it felt to us like this trip had a lot of buildup and a lot of excitement built into it. So, we took a chartered plane over to Cuba, stepped off the plane and it was dark out. And, from then on, it was just this sort of, surreal experience of being, my first travel to a foreign country. And then you're going to a country, that is a throwback to the 1950s. You know, every vehicle is it's like time stopped. And so it just felt so exotic. And everyone told us to get the Cuban cigars and, you got to go out. And we weren't angels. We certainly were out checking things out. And so one night we had an off night. We went to a little cigar stand and, I don't think I'd ever really smoked a cigar in my life. And, we bought these cigars and I took about four puffs. I thought I was going to fall on the ground. So it was a great life experience, as much as the baseball part of it was a blast, the life experience part of it was really something. And I think all of us were very happy. Honestly, we were very happy to get back to the United States. It was 7 days. It was just so different and so exotic for a bunch of college kids that we were happy to get back to American soil. But looking back on it, it was incredible.
And so then the next summer, you're on Team USA again, and here come the 88 Summer Olympics in Seoul, Korea. How was at the beginning, when the team convened in 1988, how was that experience different for you than the year prior, having been through it once already?
So the next year in 88, when it was an Olympic year, it just seemed like the intensity was ramped up, a ton, just the attention, the seriousness of our approach. And we were young, we were 20, 21 year old kids, but again, now it was the Olympics, and having been to the Pan Am Games, we got a little taste of the village, and we got a little taste of competing and opening ceremonies and what that all experience was like. So, that team was a little bit more set than the Pan American team. There were a few positions that were open. There were a few guys that were added. But for the most part, we kind of knew what that team was, who that was going to be. And we knew each other from the previous year. So it was like a reunion and a new journey all at the same time. And, we traveled a little bit better. We got more attention. We played in nicer ballparks. We went to Japan and came back, and then we played in the World Championships in Italy. Then we went to Seoul went back to Japan. We went to Seoul for the Olympics. So, it felt big, it felt fun and big and like we had the full weight of the United States Baseball Federation pulling for us. And it was just amazing.
You pitched a complete game, as a matter of fact, in the 5-3 win over Japan in what determined the gold medal for the United States. It obviously felt big. Compare that to the big feeling of the win in Cuba the year before. Was it even grander? What's it like to to be given an Olympic gold medal?
Well, it's just extraordinary. It was the biggest moment, team moment of my baseball career, because of the experience, you know, and because of, we had just looked to this moment for 2 years, 2 summers, essentially, but, you know, there was so many small hotels that we stayed in. There were so many patios, so many dugouts that we sat in and just tried to visualize the Olympics and tried to visualize how we would feel out there and tease each other. You know, who would pitch if we were in the semifinal game, or who would pitch the gold medal game? And we tried to put ourselves in that position, you know, and it seemed really scary. And, you know, after we had been through so much together, you know, how would you hold up? And it worked out. You know, Ben McDonald was on that team, and he was, you know, a tremendously talented pitcher, and he pitched the previous game and we won, and so we made it to the gold medal game, and Mark Marcus named me the starter, and it was, you know, that was it. It was the culmination of thousands of miles traveled, of college guys coming from, you know, everywhere from Stanford to USC to UConn to, you know, Miami, New Orleans, you know, guys, you know, came together for this moment and to be out there and to be on the mound. And you know, we talked about feeling like you belong. That was the ultimate feeling of belonging, and to be out there for the final out ground ball to Robin Ventura, our third baseman. It's funny. It was three straight ground balls in the ninth inning, right to Robin. And the first one, he threw it almost over Tino Martinez's head. Tino was playing first base, and Tino jumped up and just snagged it and came down on the base and got the first guy out, the first Japanese batter. The next pitch, ground ball straight to Robin again, and he threw this one not quite as high, but still not a perfect throw across the diamond. And Tino caught it, came down on the bag, and we're one out away. And the next pitch, ground ball, left-handed batter, straight to Robin again. And Robin threw it across the infield. This time, Dave Silvestri, our shortstop, screaming at him, you know, hit him in the chest. and threw a perfect strike across the infield. And you know, we had a mob scene. And it was just to be at the bottom of that pile. And it was just really, really gratifying and memorable.
Man, I can't believe we got, 20 minutes into talking about those teams, and Robin Ventura is a name that didn't come up yet. You guys in consecutive years won Golden Spikes Awards, and it just goes to show. I think, like, I'm going to have a really fun time 20 years from now, say, looking at the rosters of the collegiate national teams that I'm calling games for and getting to know and sort of reminiscing on how they were at the time, how everything's panned out for them now. You know, it's easy for us to sit here and say now that, you know, you had a 10-year major league career. Robin Ventura did what he did in the major leagues. Tino Martinez, Frank Thomas, Greg Olson, all those guys. It's easy in hindsight, right? Who at the time did you see and think to yourself, now, this guy is going to be the greatest of all of us?
I think everybody on those two teams would have told you that Ty Griffin was in the top couple players, you know, if not the best player on that team. Our second baseman from Georgia Tech, yeah. He was a top 10 pick by the Chicago Cubs, switch hitter. I think he won the MVP of the Pan American Games. You know, he hit for power. He hit for average. He was a good fielder. They used to give player of the game plaques out when we traveled around with the team. And he had, I don't think he could carry all of them, how many, you know, great games he had for us. And Ty is, you know, unfortunately, Ty, you know, he didn't have a big league career. But he was, that doesn't diminish in any way, shape, or form. And we had a lot of guys, Tommy Goodwin in the outfield, you know, he had a long big league career. And Charles Nagy, you know, great friend, great pitcher. Most every guy on the team made it in some way, shape, or form to the big leagues. But I don't think that anybody who played for those teams differentiates the experience by what the people would go on to do in the big leagues. You know, everyone thinks that. I think it's kind of its own separate experience. And you know, it doesn't really matter. You know, Robin was such a great player, and I played with Robin in the big leagues with the White Sox for a while, and I loved it, being back on a team with him. But more so because we were friends, you know, and it just, you know, that we really was a close knit group, and what you went on to do afterwards didn't matter much to anybody.
Now we discussed at the very beginning of this conversation, you're known for being someone who achieved great success despite being born without a right hand, and you're now a motivational speaker. So when I was pouring through some stuff through your Team USA experience, a quote jumped out to me, and it was I can't remember the media outlet, but and I'm paraphrasing. This was from the after the game, I believe, at Cuba or in Havana that you pitched, and it was you know, you were great in answering the question, but you sort of offhand said, you know, you were getting a little tired of being asked about your hand. And as a player, I'm sure you would have liked to have been thought of as the same as everyone else. It's part of what drove you, I'm sure. But it seems you recognized an opportunity somewhere along the way to use your experience to help inspire others. How, when, by how much has your thinking changed on that? Because I mean, I think it's safe to say you view it differently now than you did at 19 or 20 years old, right?
Yeah, that's 100%. And I don't mean to offer the excuse. I cringe a little bit, you know, when I think back on that. If ever there was a time when I did have a little bit of a chip on my shoulder, I believe it was during that time. You know, I wanted it so badly. You know, I wanted to do well, and I wanted to be, you know, considered in the same realm as these guys that I was playing with. And so I, you know, I did feel that. It wasn't until I got to the major leagues, and that I started to realize the scope of baseball, you know, and, you know, went to Boston and New York and Texas and Toronto and Oakland and everywhere. And families, you know, started to come to the ballparks, with kids who looked like me and who faced the same challenges as me, missing a hand or part of an arm or, you know, lots and lots and lots of different things. And so I didn't really realize how many people were out there like me, you know, and what it meant for them to have somebody to talk about and have as an experience. And that didn't change how I looked at my own pursuit, you know, of trying to be the best I could be.
Yeah.
But it offered a ton of perspective, and it helped to soften up a little bit of that, inward looking feeling that I had at 19 and 20 years old, when it was just all about me and how it was affecting me. You know, I started to see that there was more to it, and it still took time. And truly, it wasn't until after my career was over where I really feel like I came to terms with the idea of what it means to have someone to look to, you know, and so I'm proud of that now. I feel like I handled it well at some points, and I feel like I didn't handle it all that well at other points, but I did the best I could. And, speaking to families and kids now, I'm just so happy that there's that connection.
Well, let's get into your big league career, because there are some,
some great moments within that that I want to ask you about for sure. You, after being drafted in the 36th round out of high school, went 8th overall out of Michigan. Obviously, created a name for yourself in a big way with the Team USA stints. In your big league career, obviously some growing pains to start, as is going to happen with anyone your age being thrust into that situation. What clicked for you in the 91 season at, what were you, 23 years old, and you finished third in the Cy Young Award voting?
You know, one summer, I was released by the Angels, and I went through a really difficult time. I was out of the game for a while. And I was young, you know, I was 30, and I felt like I just hadn't quite left, you know, as my best self. You know, I hadn't pitched as well, and I signed with the White Sox in an attempt to make a comeback. And you know, it was the strangest summer of my life, but I started off in Hickory, North Carolina, and I'm not sure if that's the Appalachian League, but I know it's probably close.
it's not far from it. That is the South Atlantic League. So they are now known as the Crawdads. Yeah.
Exactly. The Hickory Crawdads. I was on the Hickory Crawdads, and then I went to, in one summer, I went from Hickory, North Carolina to Winston-Salem, the Warthogs.
Yeah.
Went to Birmingham, Alabama, played for the Barons, and then up to Calgary, and ultimately made it back to, you know, the big leagues in September. And so I had saw the entire minor league experience in one summer. And it was crazy, and it was so great. And those tiny locker rooms and those metal folding chairs and, you know, a little TV in the corner with a Major League Baseball game on. And it's hard to really put into words. You know, it was really a heck of a journey. And I embraced that experience because it is a big part of the appreciation, you know, for having a year like 1991, you know, where I kind of started to learn how to pitch a little bit. You know, was able to throw more off speed pitches and you know, throw my fastball with consistency where I wanted it. And I went on a roll in the second half and you know, really felt like I had made it. I really felt like I had, you know, I could compete against any lineup, any batter, any opposing pitcher. And 91 was really special for that reason.
So a couple years later, and I'm always fascinated at the perspective of guys who have been in this position, just because when you compare it to those maybe listening to this who have more, and I'm using my air quotes, of course, more normal day-to-day jobs, and the concept of being traded does not exist for them in the same fashion, right? So in the major leagues, and I know you were going through a contract negotiation at the time with the Angels, but here it is, 1993, and you find out you've been traded. Not only are you going to another team, you're going to the New York Yankees at that point. Put into perspective, because like the accountants listening or the high school baseball coaches listening or whomever, that's not something that's likely to happen to them in their professions. And I know it, even though you know it's part of the process, it's still just so, so different.
Yeah. It's a jarring feeling. You know, back in when I was traded, we didn't have, you know, the means of communication that we have today. So I found out, you know, we were in Hawaii on a vacation in December, and I got home off the plane with my wife. It was raining at LAX, and my mother-in-law picked us up, and she was crying. And then I was like, you know, what's going on? So, well, you got traded to the Yankees today. and we truly didn't know. It was so weird.
Wow.
It is jarring, you know, because you're used to a way of life, and the Angels were the only team I knew. I really thought I was going to be with the Angels for my whole career. I was negotiating a contract and hadn't really turned down anything. I just, you know, hadn't signed. And so I thought we were just negotiating. And then all of a sudden, you know, that was gone. The contract offer was gone. And I was, you know, sent out the door. And I almost every player who's traded, I would tell you for the first time, is, you know, their first reaction is looking back. You know, it's sort of, you know, is it, you know, I was thinking this was my family and this is what I was going to be with. And I admired Alan Trammell growing up, who played with one team his whole career. And then that was just something I wanted to do. And all of a sudden that wasn't the case anymore. So yeah, it is jarring. It's, you know, you learn, that you're a piece and, you know, it is a business and you really can't be too sentimental about it, as easy as it is to be nostalgic about Major League Baseball.
I think about your beginnings, Michigan guy, you know, a Midwestern by all means disposition, and your two teams that you had played for by that point in your career were maybe the two biggest markets in the league. What was it like in New York, comparatively speaking? And by this point, you know, but because of the Olympics and because of the Team USA experience, I would imagine you had, even before your time with the Angels, gotten to a point where you were pretty good with, you know, having a lot of media around, and you know, even though you might have resented it to a certain degree earlier, I feel like you probably were the perfect type of player to handle New York media. Was that the case?
I don't know. I know I would disagree. I wasn't. I was a little sensitive to criticism, and you know, I used baseball and sports success, you know, to fight that sensitivity for a lot of my life. And when you're having success, that flaw never shows up, you know, because you don't have to defend yourself. You know, you don't have to be exposed to scrutiny. And in New York, for the first time, really, I sort of struggled. I didn't pitch great. I was a 500 pitcher, and which wasn't terrible, but the expectation was for more. And so, you know, with the New York Times and the New York Post and three different other newspapers and the television shows and the radio and the TV, and, you know, there's just so much more attention. And in the city, you know, I was living in the city at the time. So everywhere you went, people recognize you and have a comment, you know, good or bad. You know, I there were times, frankly, I didn't handle it perfectly. You know, I was a little bit sensitive to not performing the way other people thought I should be, or the way even I thought I should be. So, and New York kind of toughens you up a little bit. I wouldn't trade a second for playing there. I loved it. And I, you know, it really kind of made my wife and I grow up, you know, because we were so protected in California. Our family was there. And so to go to New York, face that scrutiny, face that attention, there's nothing like it. There's nothing like playing for the Yankees. And I'm so happy to have done it, even though it wasn't, you know, always pleasant.
Well, then later that year, you have the, I guess the highlight moment, I think, of your big league career. And you throw a no hitter for the Yankees against the Indians. What was it, September of that season? I mean, however you felt about New York fans and media prior to that must have changed after that game, at least temporarily, right? What's it like to have that moment as a Yankee?
There's nothing like it. There's nothing like it. Playing for the New York Yankees, I read somewhere, and I can't remember, somebody described it as a hyper existence, you know, and it kind of is, you know, just everything is magnified. And so, you know, the pinstripes, Yankee Stadium, the scrutiny and just the history. I loved all that stuff, you know, having grown up in outside of Detroit, you know, the old English D and the Tigers, that meant a lot. And so, you know, to pitch a no hitter in Yankee Stadium, just a magical day. I, you know, against a good hitting ball club, the Cleveland Indians, teammates made a lot of great plays that day. I, you know, got a little lucky, but I pitched a great ball game, and it just, you know, I'll never forget that evening walking around Manhattan with my wife, and, you know, taxi cabs honking and the early edition of the Sunday morning papers being out and signing autographs and getting mobbed. And, you know, it was just otherworldly. It was just a different level. And, you know, I'm so thankful to have that connection to the city. I've always loved New York City. I've always loved the people and the personality of the city, and to have, you know, a lasting connection, you know, of memory and of people who remember that game is something really, really special in my life.
Pitchers use the term, the expression, being in the zone. Do you remember feeling more in the zone, or however you want to put it, than usual when you went in for work that day?
No, it was a strange game. It was, you know, I had pitched against the Indians. You don't often pitch against the same team twice in a row, if for a starting pitcher. And that was a strange anomaly in the schedule that year. But I pitched against the Indians before my start before that, and I was terrible. I mean, I was just awful. I don't think I made it through the third inning. I can't remember the particular stats, but I was knocked out of the game. I was frustrated. It had been a tough year. I'd been traded. I really kind of hit a low point for the season. And even though the team came back and won that game, I was just really down. And so the last thing on my mind that next start, a Saturday in Yankee Stadium, although I love day games and I loved pitching in Yankee Stadium, was a feeling of confidence and being in the zone. It was not that. And for some reason though, that I was usually a very stoic, you know, my approach was quiet on the bench and very, you know, I tried to do visualization and I tried to let go of the previous inning. But that day I was pretty lighthearted. I felt, you know, kind of like, hey, the worst has happened, you know, I mean, even though it hadn't, you know, but that's the way I looked at it. And there was this sort of freedom to that. Like, you know what, let's see what happens here. I mean, if I make it past the third inning, it'll be improvement. And so I was joking around a little bit that day with Jimmy Key on the bench and Scott Kamenicki, my Michigan teammate. And then all of a sudden, boom, you look up and you realize that it's a no hitter. And then it starts to change, of course. So I just remember really appreciating it, you know, being in the stadium and feeling my teammates and the superstition and you know, the hopefulness of it. And to be honest with you, Daron, you know, the ninth inning of the Olympics really helped me in that game, you know, because it was the exact same feeling. You know, it was, I had the exact same hopefulness against Japan in Korea in that ninth inning as I did that day in Yankee Stadium. You know, you go through that and you realize that all you can control as a pitcher is how the ball comes out of your hand, no matter how much this means to you. You know, no matter how much this result would be so great. And so having gone through that in the Olympics really helped me that day in Yankee Stadium.
That's fantastic. I think that's going to provide, Jim, we have a lot of younger baseball players who have informed us that they regularly listen to this. I think you playing, you know, kind of loose that day is going to be, in turn, a pretty good lesson for them, right? I know younger players can take it a little seriously to the point of tightening up and that sort of thing. Was that your first no-hitter since your first Little League game?
I can't remember. I think I may have had one in college or somewhere close to one or been a part of one.
Yeah.
But I can't even remember. I don't think that I had seen one in the big leagues or been a part of one, you know, on my team or against one for a while. I'm trying, that's a good question. But it is, yeah. I mean, you can get in your own way. And there's tons of ways to prepare for a game. And I took the mental side of it very seriously. I took the physical side of it very seriously. And, you know, at some point you have to let it go. You know, you have to let all that stuff go and pitch with intention, of course, but, you know, also with just trust and trust that you've done the work, that you're prepared, and that your stuff is good enough. And I definitely remember that feeling, in Yankee Stadium that day, like, this is good enough and I'm going to throw one pitch at a time, the old cliche, with as much intention as I can and let the results fall where they may.
Jim, tremendous stuff. I cannot thank you enough for doing this today. It's been a lot of fun. And certainly as a representative of USA Baseball, we're really proud to have you on our roster of all-time alums. And I know a lot, maybe not with the close affiliation to USAB, feel the same way in terms of their admiration for you and the way you've carried yourself and used your story to inspire many. So thanks again for the time. This has been a thrill.
Well, I appreciate it. It's my pleasure, and I'm very lucky to have a lot of proud affiliations in my life, and USA Baseball is certainly right there at the very top of that. And it was fun to relive some of this stuff. So thanks for having me on. I'm proud to be a part of the lineup that you put together.
That will do it for episode 29. I loved getting to talk with Jim Abbott, such an inspiring person, and we need as many stories like his of hope and perseverance as we can get. On the next episode of Covering the Bases, how about one of baseball's top prospects, former Golden Spikes Award winner and national champion for Oregon State, the 2019 number one overall pick in the MLB draft, Adley Rutschman, will be with me. But until then, stay safe, and we'll catch you later.